Dr. Srinivas Jayaraman to present the guest lecture.
Oh.
Forestry construction.
No, I was actually telling Dr. Radhakrishnan that I will take as a question rather than putting a presentation. I think you all do it. I don't do anything very different from what you're doing it. I was actually messaging Dr. Radhakrishnan earlier on saying that we can have an open discussion. I don't mind. But let's not make it into a kind of a didactic lecture. It'll be a waste of time for the trainees at the moment. Happy to take any discussion, open discussion in a way, what's helpful for them. Dr. Radhakrishnan?
Yeah. Anyway, if you have some series or something like that, you can just put it on. Otherwise, we will just have it like a...
No, remember, when we had the problem of technical connectivity morning, I didn't prepare a presentation thinking I'm not going to get even the connection because there was a problem. We didn't get the link until later in the morning this morning working. So that's why I was messaging you privately.
What would be your preference or kind of reconstruction you plan in a short statured woman who has got a like a stage 3 breast cancer, who has completed treatment and then including chemo radiation with the estrogen receptor positive, and she patient has also been put on tamoxifen and HER2 new oncogen positive kind of patient, short stature and post chemo radiation on one side with the other opposite breast is a quite pendulous breast, and the abdomen is obese and is quite short stature female, no other comorbid illnesses. What kind of reconstruction would you plan when you plan for a delayed reconstruction?
Sure. Thank you. Like for everything else, we'll have to start with what the patient would prefer. If the contralateral breast, as you said, it is droopy, if the patient has completed her family, if she wants to have a breast reduction or an uplift.
Amaya, turn the fan, please.
That may be helpful because you say she's a short statured, but abdominal skin is available. If the abdomen area is available, if the patient is fit to have a slightly longer operation, my personal preference will be to use a free DF flap as a reconstruction, as a delayed reconstruction, because it provides the best amount of tissue in one sitting without any need for an implant-based reconstruction. That will be my first go-to preference, if at all possible, if it is safe. But again, I haven't seen her. But if we have, but the very way you say short statured, height doesn't matter. If she has enough tissue in the lower abdominal area as a pannus that I can take it and close properly, I would go to that as a main option. The second option would be whether, depending on the patient's hand dominance, their job, I may consider looking at an option of either a pedicled LD with or without an implant. If there is enough tissue in the back, I would prefer to do as a purely autologous latissimus dorsi tissue reconstruction. But if the contralateral breast is very large, very droopy, maybe you won't have enough in the parascapular area of the fat deposit, even if you can bring the whole of the LD muscle. So I will have a discussion with the patient whether they are okay to have an implant. In that case, LD and an implant is enough. If they don't want to have an implant, you want to keep it everything as autologous tissue, then I may suggest them to reduce the contralateral breast to a good size and then match that with autologous latissimus dorsi muscle and the fat around that area in a kind of stage reconstruction. So in discussion, it starts with what is the patient's expectation, the safety, what is available, and then what is safe to do. That's the way I will go about in this situation.
Suppose if the internal membrane nodes also have been irradiated and axilla also has been irradiated, what will be your choice of, will you once again go in for a DF with the donor donor site from the contralateral internal mammary, or you will go in for a contralateral tram or kind of?
No, I think irradiation with the current technique of irradiation, artery may still be okay. Vein may be a problem. It may be very friable. It may tear, or we will find problem with the venous anastomosis itself. So I wouldn't worry about using the artery on the same side. I don't need to go contralateral. If I open up and find if the vein is not good but the artery is good, then I can use other ways of bringing a venous turn down. We can do a cephalic vein turn down into the chest area, because that is possible. It's an accepted technique to do that. From the ipsilateral cephalic vein, start from the cubital fossa, tunnel it down, and single anastomosis again, bring it into the chest wall towards the internal mammary. And the flap vein is anastomosed to cephalic vein, flap artery is anastomosed to the internal mammary artery. I would keep them the same side if possible. Sorry, you're muted. Radhakrishnan, you're muted.
Would the patients accept the additional scar for the cephalic vein harvest?
Well, again, it comes to a discussion with the patient. If you want to transfer a large amount of tissue, which is available in the abdomen, and if they want to avoid an implant, then the scar, you don't have to have a linear scar over the cephalic vein. You can do multiple horizontal stab incisions kind of thing, and tunnel the vein up towards the cephalic junction. There'll be a series of small tunnel, and you can actually make them less rather than one long linear incision across the whole of the arm from cubital fossa to the chest. You can make multiple serial cuts that may be acceptable in some cases.
In general, I think in UK, the preferred vessel is the internal mammary rather than the thoracodosa.
I use internal mammary almost exclusively. Nearly 100% of my cases I do internal mammary, just so that the well vascularized part of the flap is closer to the midline rather than in the axilla. But there are people who use thoracodorsal as a primary area of doing that, but then less so. Internal mammary is the preferred option for most people. I agree.
And because
to go for internal mammary is that, again, if they have had any previous axillary operations, you don't know how the thoracodorsal vessels, how safe they are and how comfortably available they are. Internal mammary seems to be okay in most cases because it is deeper. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and only one, intercostal, the cartilage is removed and then the whole vessel is taken out, right?
Well, what we do now more and more is that I start off between the intercostals, between the two ribs. I don't even take any rib.
Mm-hmm.
I go first to open up, clean up the soft tissue around the vessel as much as possible between one to another rib, be it third to fourth or second to third, and then see whether there is enough length for us to use for anastomosis. And if I need any longer length than that, then only I'll go to take some of the rib, the costal cartilage. I try and keep them in between the costal cartilages, so I don't even need to nibble out the bone in a way. So we reduce the morbidity. At least 70% of the time, I don't need to take the rib anymore now. Okay. I just do in between the ribs.
Right. And some amount of the muscle is also removed?
Yes, some of the pec major, just overlying that area, and the intercostal muscles need to be removed to get down to the internal mammary. That's necessary. Yeah. But your flap is going to fill that area anyway, so there's no contour problems there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah.
There was one question in the chat box. Let me have a look at it. What significance does cup size of the breast have in an oncoplastic reconstruction? Madhavi, you asked for that question. Cup size is an indication of the contralateral breast. But cup sizes are variable, as women would confirm, from the make of the bra. What fits a C cup may be different from a D cup. So it is an indication. So to a large extent, if you have enough soft tissue in the abdomen to provide the same volume to the other side breast, then you do that by a microvascular transformation anyway, reconstruction anyway. But if it is not possible, you may have to consider doing some adjunct procedures like the contralateral breast. If they don't want to disturb it by surgery, you can do some liposuction to reduce that if they have completed the family. If it's a young woman who hasn't started the family, that you can't really do that option, you have to counsel them appropriately. So capsaicin is just an indication, but it is not going to be the only factor. It has to be discussed with the patient. Dr. Radhakrishnan, there's another question down there. There's an option of thoracoacromial pedicle as a donor vessel.
That's yes,
that is correct. That is available, but it's your pedicle length, then you have to be longer. When you take your DF flap pedicle, you're going towards your infraclavicular area for the thoracoacromial pedicle. So the orientation of the flap will change. The pedicle length may be a little bit of a problem for you. The big advantage of internal mammary is that you don't need a long pedicle. It is right below in the depth. So if you have a long pedicle, depending on where the perforator is, you can use thoracoacromial. It's not a problem. It's a good vessel to use. Yeah. Dr. Radhakrishnan, you're on mute again.
Yeah. Do you use any, anytime have you used muscle sparing tram?
When we use a DF,
nowadays we are using DF, but before that, when we were postgraduates, we used to use that also. What is your take on that?
No, my view is that do whatever you do to make the flap be healthy. If you need to take a small cuff of muscle because the perforator is very small, then take a cuff of muscle. That's not a problem. If you are trying to protect the muscle but lose the flap, we have not gained anything. Whereas even if you take a small cuff of muscle, you can reinforce it with a mesh within the rectus abdominis sheath, and you can provide a support for the abdominal wall. So your main focus is to make sure the flap is well perfused. And if you need to take a muscle cuff along with the perforator, not a problem. It's not a failure in any sense.
The fat grafting prior to using LD in an irradiated chest?
If we use a fat graft in that sense, it is mainly to help the skin become a bit softer and change the quality of the skin. So in some women, even though they have had radiotherapy, the skin is fairly soft and supple, then we don't need a fat grafting to them. But if there are areas that are quite scarred, then a fat transfer will be helpful to soften the skin envelope before we bring the LD into that. Yes, there's a place for it.
There's another question in the chat box. This is from Likita. What are the various lymphatic surgeries and prevention of lymphedema?
Okay, again, in the... whether as a plastic surgeon, who does a reconstruction, it's your breast surgeon should know that they should be engaging with you not to have a very radical axillary clearance in a way. So with more breast surgeons are being very careful about their procedure and the technique, the risk of lymphedema is not as much as it used to be in the past. However, if you are going to do a free tissue transfer like a DF flap, you could combine it with inguinal nodes and combine it as a single stage breast reconstruction as well as a lymph nodal transfer, microvascular nodal transfer, if it is possible. So when you are trying to preserve the superficial inferior epigastric vein, when you raise the DF flap, you extend your dissection downwards towards the groin nodes and you include them in your pedicle, in your flap tissue. And therefore, you can orientate the lymph nodal transfer to that. You're bringing in fresh lymph nodes to the axilla by along with part of your DF flap reconstruction itself. So in a select cases, if you plan it properly, you can do both for nodal, bringing in a fresh vascularized nodal tissue to the axilla, as well as the breast tissue in the same time. That's possible. If you don't do that, if you want to do just for lymphedema alone, the other techniques will come, like either a nodal to venous anastomosis, or they are coming into supramicrosurgery level. Ideally, you want to do a lymphatic anastomosis. But if techniques of supramicrosurgery, we are looking at 10-0, 11-0, and 12-0 necessary, very flimsy vessels. And it's a very specialized treatment. People go to Japan, to Koshima, to get trained in that. He's a kind of father of supramicrosurgery. If you don't have the technical expertise, then it may be just a lymphatico venous anastomosis may be sufficient. And that can be done as a standalone procedure for the lymphedema itself. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. There is another question.
Yeah.
Dr. Madhuri himself.
Turn 180 degree prior to insert. Won't the fourth zone come laterally in that? Wait a minute, I can't.
Won't the fourth zone come laterally in that case? And how will we be able to place our first key stitch in such a flap when we are unsure of the zone's viability?
Right, okay. I don't rotate the flap in any sense, depending on which side you harvest, of course. If you're right reconstruction, if you're taking your main pedicle on the left side, contralateral side, then your zone one and zone two, if you're doing internal mammary, they are right where you need it. You don't need to rotate it. You can just bring it straight in. Yeah. Because the zone three, which is the very lateral end of the left side, you can trim it. And zone four, which is the very lateral end on the right side, can be trimmed. But zone one and two will be right where you want to. You don't need to rotate the flap in any way. If you're using ipsilateral, sometimes you may have to rotate it, but it is not a problem. We don't need to rotate it all the time. What I will try to do is, when we raise the flap in the abdomen, we will obviously let it perfuse for a little bit. We know that zone four is going to go, so take it away anyway. You don't need to bother keeping it. But between zone one, two, and three, you decide the best vascularized parts. And you just have to maybe a little bit. It doesn't have to be 180 degree turned. It may be you sit it obliquely. Whichever way, your focus is to get the pedicle into the internal mammary vessel without any torsion, without any twist. The flap can then be adjusted in any way. That's not a problem.
I think Dr. Mehta can come. Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Sorry, I had to take the mic off because it was quite painful in the I don't know why. Okay. The one other comment came on, comments on breast conservation surgery from Girish. Breast conservation surgery is good. As long as a good collaboration between the breast oncology surgeon and reconstructive surgeon, then you can plan it properly. And clearly, the first aim is for cancer management. We shouldn't compromise that. But if the location of the tumor allows you to do some oncoplastic techniques to do your resection and preserve some shape, then that's a good thing for the patient, of course. But it needs a good discussion and proper assessment and a good plastic surgical skill to involve in doing that. So if any of your breast surgeons, oncologic surgeons, want to do a breast conservation surgery, encourage them, but be involved in planning the technique, depending on where the tumor is. Do you do a lot of them, Dr. Radhakrishnan, breast conservation or oncoplastic breast surgery?
Not very often, but we do.
Yeah. Dr. Bhave?
Actually, I don't do breast. I'm more into aesthetic.
Sure.
Can I take this opportunity to ask you, what is your lipofilling technique?
I still use the Coleman technique because I think it works well. It's just that it's how you harvest the fat. That's the main thing, because you need to protect your fat cells, not being aggressive. Depending on large volume, I may do different techniques to bring in different devices available. But the small volume transfers, I use mainly a low suction device for me to harvest the fat. I still use centrifuge, but only for 3 minutes, but not for 5 minutes, a longer time, 3 minutes, because it still allows me to separate the other unnecessary cells away and then fat cell. But I don't completely empty all of that rich plasma with that. I sometimes leave it along with the fat that I need to transfer, because it enhances the retention of the fat that you do. Yeah, so that's okay. I never didn't use Brava at all in the UK. In fact, not many surgeons use Brava in the UK. So I was surprised when people talked about in Indian sector for Brava reconstruction.
That is because Dr. Roy Kanjur has done it. And yeah. Now more of us are going for expansion vibration lipofilling with our right. Power assisted machines.
Correct. That's probably better. That's probably better.
Yes.
I met Dr. Roy in Ahmedabad. Yeah. I think his techniques are good. The way to keep it at nighttime to make it manageable is a good innovation.
Yes.
Particularly for Indian sector, it's a good innovation and helpful for the patient. So I agree.
Yes.
But the discomfort factor, many don't use it in the UK at all.
Right.
Dr. Radhakrishnan, I think if anything else, I think I know that you are later into the night. For me, it's afternoon.
Yeah.
But I know it's getting late for you in the night.
Yeah.
You want to close it?
Yeah.
Dr. Lakshmi, Dr. Mehta's talk is also there. No?
Mehta's talk is there.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Invite Dr. Mehta.
Sorry, go ahead. Go ahead, please do.
Deliver talk.
I will try to keep it very short because I have actually written very extensively about it already. And I think because of my visiting professorship lectures, most of the PGs have heard about it. But I definitely would like to really present a little bit, mainly to bring about the awareness, because axillary breast is actually dismissed as a minor surgery by most, and whosoever comes across it tries to lay hands on it, and the aesthetic result is actually not very good, and this is a good domain for plastic surgeons to conquer. So let me begin with accessory breast. Accessory breast is a congenital condition in which abnormally located breast tissue is there in addition to the normal breast. Can be located anywhere on the body, not necessarily restricted to the milk line, but commonest places where we find them are chest wall and the axilla. I think Likhita mentioned about Kajava classification. It is very difficult to remember, so I gave it a pictorial form. I use a solid circle to represent the breast tissue, a hollow circle to represent the areola, and a rod to represent nipple. And that makes it very easy. We can, in this digital era, we can easily forget about the actual types and just represent the breast that you see in this format for the sake of record.
Madam, just one thing, madam. Madam, can you just make it full screen, madam?
Actually, I have put it full screen only.
Okay. We are actually seeing your other Right India stories. I mean, a lot of other things are there.
No, but I have made it full screen, full screen. Actually.
Okay, madam.
You can come across axillary breast anywhere. This was in our ICU. This patient presented to me for mole removal. And it is very important to be aware, because below there can be some breast tissue which also warrants removal. Now, this is axillary breast is just anatomical description of the accessory breast. It can be any Kajava type, but so far I have come across only type 4.
Actually, your PPT is not to be seen by all of us. It is not shared or projected, madam.
Okay. But then it is only share content, then I choose the screen in which my PPT is open, right?
Yeah, that you do, ma'am.
1 minute, let me...
Share screen option will be there next.
I have taken the same option. My PPT I can see is completely open on my screen. Can you see now? Okay.
No.
Do I have to? Okay. See. Can you see it now?
Hello. First slide only is seen.
We can, we can see the entire the folder. We can see all the different files in your folder.
Actually, we are seeing the desktop.
No, but that is very surprising. Anyway,
you're opening that open share tray you have opened in that bottom.
Yes, I have
done that. No? Okay,
see now. Here, now you can see the desktop, right.
Yes.
So now I am opening the PowerPoint on that same desktop. Can you see it?
The first slide is visible, but it is part of the screen.
Management of axillary breast, first slide. Yeah.
Ma'am, you want to drag it to the desktop and then present from the desktop rather than.
No, it is on the desktop. I had opened it on the desktop and kept actually. I think in that case, I don't go about it.
No.
I will close the desktop and now try. I think I'll have to give up then, because I'm really not able to.
You can send the slides to, is it possible for you to send the slides to?
Yeah, it will take time, but.
Yeah.
Okay, madam, just like what you did previously, no? Just open the share tray, madam. That bottom, this one, open share tray.
I opened. And it's, do I have to import the file somewhere? Now see, I have opened the desktop.
Okay, you opened it. I mean, you have pressed that open share tray.
Yes.
You opened that. Okay, but unfortunately, we are not able to see that. How do you want to join? Continue on this browser. Yeah, now we can see you on this one, madam. Now you have to go to your.
Now you can see, right?
Now it is fine. Yeah, perfect.
Okay. So, from the current slide, right? So, So I was here, and so now often there is a grilling of the students on whether the breast seen in the axilla is axillary tail of Spencer or an accessory breast. But from the management point of view, we just have to remove the swelling. The patient comes to us with request to remove the swelling. And when we open, we will definitely know if the Spencer's foramen continuation is there, and we can take that decision on the table. Axillary breast is a congenital condition, but it becomes symptomatic when there are hormonal surges, and it can happen even in the perimenopausal age. This is the classification of axillary breasts that I have proposed, and you can see cases similar. Case similar to shown by Likhita here. This is paramammary, central axillary, and medial arm. The importance of especially the paramammary and the medial arm cases is that any surgeon who is not really initiated will try to take incision right on the lump and give a very poor aesthetic outcome. For all these three types, we can restrict our incision to the hair-bearing area of the axilla. This is actually appreciated by the patients, not only because it hides the scar, but also reduces the hair-bearing area in the axilla, which most of the women don't want to have. So they go for laser hair removal of the axilla also. So if that area is reduced, it is additional bonus to them. Everyone knows the anatomy of the axilla, but important nerves to remember are intercostobrachial nerve, which most of the times, at least in 80 to 85% of the patients, when you open, you will always find intercostobrachial nerve, and it has to be saved. Now, it is very important to understand why we should not go directly for liposuction. When the axilla is put in abduction, the neurovascular bundles, which are here the axilla is in adduction, the neurovascular bundles are at the apex of the axilla. So these are thrown towards the floor when the axilla is put in abduction, and that is the position in which we operate. So it is better to be cautious, do the excision first, and then do liposuction wherever it is required. These are the aesthetic landmarks of the axilla. Again, I will not go into the details. But from the axillary breast point of view, we have to note that this axillary floor is concave. The pyramidal axilla has got a concave floor, and anything that disturbs the concavity, be it the projection or bulge of the axillary breast, or tethering of that floor to the underlying structures, which produces depressions, is aesthetically not acceptable. I will tell you about it when I go for surgical details. These are the axillary aesthetic lines I have described, anterior axillary line. Here it is very important to note that the anterior axillary line goes into a depression that is normally located behind the breast, and if the patient has got fat in this area, which is very common, middle-aged ladies always have a bar of fat here. If you do liposuction here, they are much happier with the outcome. So you have to deliver a little more than they expect. See, the axillary breast is quite a concern in younger girls. This was a young girl with such huge breasts, where a plastic surgeon will focus on the breast. But look at these axillary breasts, which brought her to me. And once this is the post-operative photograph, she was very happy. She did not want any change in the breast. So that is the importance of axillary aesthetic lines. This is a symptomatology. I think we have talked about it in detail. But when you talk about wearing proper clothes, please remember that our Indian patients may not be talking about wearing sleeveless or exposed clothes, but they are uncomfortable in their clothes because of the sweating, stinking, and maceration and improper fit. Maintaining arms in proper, inability to maintain arms in proper posture is one of the very, very common complaints. Pain can occur in the axillary swelling along with the menstrual cycle, and it can be along the medial arm if that breast tissue is inflamed. Remember that any disease that can affect the normal breast will affect the axillary breast also. So sometimes the intercostobrachial nerve may be caught and there can be pain along the medial arm. Older patients also come for this surgery because they are worried about malignancy. Differential diagnosis is very important in our country. In addition to common causes like lipoma and sebaceous cyst, we have to definitely remember tubercular lymphadenopathy. This is a young girl. Our patients go by the anatomical area for which the surgeon is known. And because now they know that I am doing axilla, this patient with tubercular axillary abscess came to me for a scarless healing. So we have to be very cautious and do proper investigations and establish our diagnosis. We have discussed investigations in detail. One input I ask from my sonologist is proportion of the breast and the fatty tissue in the axillary breast. Now, what prompted me to get into this was this paper that was published in UK in 2003. Most of the papers on axillary breasts are from general surgery units, and this paper, in addition to mentioning all the common symptomatology, etc., they mentioned that the axillary breast removal is usually designated to junior residents, and in their hands the incidence of dehiscence, seroma, and infections is very high. So it is an avoidable procedure. So this gives us a area where we can really show our expertise. These are my two publications. You can go through this intake open complete chapter in which everything is given in details. Treatment options, you will see many non-plastic surgeons. Nowadays, it is a fashion to give injections for everybody. So lipolytic agents are used. Other options are liposuction, axillaplasty, and axillaplasty can also be combined with breast aesthetic surgery. Lipolytic agents is mentioned only to be condemned. This was a young patient who came to me with lipoma. This mark is because of multiple lipolytic injections she was given, and she also had already developed arm pain. This is the post-operative result after surgical excision of the lipoma. And when I opened, this is what I found. Because of multiple lipolytic injections, she had all the veins were thrombosed and the nerves and vessels were spared, but there was a congestion of the nerves. This patient had post-operatively pain and burning over the medial arm. Why liposuction should be avoided as only modality? This patient was my first patient. She came to me for non-invasive treatment of her axillary breast, and I did liposuction and see what happened. Here you can see a reasonably good result, but on the other side, the breast tissue remained and it looks as if there is excess of the glabrous area, but obviously there is non-retractile hair-bearing skin in the axilla, which is not retracted, and that is pushing the breast tissue anteriorly. This was only other patient whom I could treat with liposuction because she had purely fat. So what I choose normally is axillaplasty. as a procedure. Now, this term was coined by Lawrence Kirwan and he used it for actually treatment of bra rolls. But my definition of axillaplasty is different. Let us first see what are the standard photographs. These are the standard photographs in case of all axillary breasts that you must take. And photographs in abduction also should be documented so that you have a clue as to where the, how the aesthetic lines are running. First step is to mark all the landmarks and the aesthetic lines. Mark the skin ellipse by pinching. And as I said, in every axillary breast, it should be located in the hair bearing area as much as possible. Also mark the limit of the gland. This is because if you see, this looks so huge, but when the patient raises her arms, the swellings reduce in size significantly. So you have to always mark the patient in abduction. Now, another important technical tip is that if you see here, I'm doing the dissection. The flaps have to be always quite thick. And if you infiltrate adequately, you can always, define the exact axillary breast and all the subcutaneous fat has to be retained. You can easily find the boundary. Then as you proceed, you have the medial extent of the dissection is almost up to the lateral border of the pectoralis. Here, when you go deeper, you have to check that you have to leave the axillary fat pad behind. Sometimes even this fat pad is very thick, but it has to be preserved because otherwise you may land up in a lymphatic collection. So you most of the times you can find out the inferior limit of the axillary breast and you have to stop there. As you can see here, this is the Spencer's foramen and you have to close it if there is a extension to the main breast, and then the ends, they have to be liposucked. The anterior and posterior axillary folds have to be liposucked because otherwise this fat will fall into the axillary area and the patient will feel that nothing was done. When you complete the closure, you have to check that there is no excess tissue in the anterior and posterior axillary folds because that is another point where the aesthetic outcome can be compromised. I don't use pressure garments because the peculiar shape of the axilla, it is very difficult to fit the pressure garment. So I use this many-tailed dressing. Nowadays, instead of Dynaplast, I use non-allergic, hypoallergic dressing. So some results. Another important point is after the scar takes a long time to settle. So this is a photograph after 1 month, which is showing a dog ear, but after 6 months, it settles very well. This is here. It is after 1 month. The scar is still very prominent. So you have to counsel the patient right from the beginning that it is going to take time to settle. This is the intraoperative picture. And you see how nicely the nerves have to be dissected. Every single nerve that is going through the swelling but not reaching the part to be excised has to be preserved. Otherwise, the patient may develop postoperative neurological pain. This shows how thick the flaps have to be. If you thin the flap too much, then they will go up and stick to the axillary floor, and that will give a tethered and puckered appearance, which is not aesthetically acceptable. The other axilla was liposucked. Here also you can, even this scar takes somehow quite long time to disappear. These are some late results. This is after 6 years post-operatively. This is another patient. This is a lateral arm type of breast, but again the incision was given in the hair bearing area. Many times some people may not even diagnose this as axillary breast. So you can see the operative specimen. The paramammary type of axillary breast, here you can see the axillary lymph nodes, and they have to be preserved. You can also appreciate that a breast which looks so small from outside can turn out to be so big. See, this is the other side, and the amount of breast tissue is very huge, and this was actually a tail of Spence. Another patient with paramammary breast. Another patient. This is how the closure should look on the table. And see how big the specimens are. This is a male patient with a huge axillary lipoma. Still, you can give very good axillary aesthetic lines and avoid the scar crossing the axilla. Complications are actually not very common because even if it is hair bearing area, the scars heal very well, but sometimes they can cross the aesthetic line. There can be contour deformities, there can be pain, paresthesias, and collections in the dead space. Here everything is very good. The result is wonderful. This is one of my first patients where I started thinking about aesthetic lines. The patient was very happy, but this is what made me unhappy. That is why I thought of these aesthetic lines. And this is a common mistake that is performed by the beginners. So let us avoid that. So my consolidated approach to axillaplasty with limited liposuction is preoperative sonography, standard photographs, marking in maximum abduction in standing position, incision limited to the hair bearing area, limited elliptical excision in the direction of maximum skin laxity. It need not be necessary along any anterior axillary fold because we don't know how the skin has expanded. So best thing is to judge by pinching the skin, and wherever maximum skin laxity can be covered in arm, in abducted arm, you should mark that ellipse. Adequately thick flaps to avoid tethering, meticulous preservation of nerves, avoid injury to the axillary fat pad and lymph nodes. Liposuction is limited to dog ears and the axillary folds. So try to give a good contour to the axilla. That is what the patient has come to you for. A two-layer closure is done with arm in maximum abduction and many-tail dressing. I don't use drains or pressure garment. So in conclusion, the traditional liposuction is neither sufficient or efficient in treating axillary breast because the breast tissue is tough. There is issue of handling nerves and vessels in abducted position where these come in the vulnerable position. There is non-retraction of the hair-bearing skin. So some skin has to be removed. There is a difficulty in wearing pressure garment. Careful dissection of the involved nerves is essential, and scars in the axilla heal imperceptibly even if it is they are in the hair bearing skin. Thank you.
I guess quite nice. Any questions in the chat box? Hello.
Oh, wait, thank you very much. That's a very good collection of cases.
Thank you.
I see that you get, as you correctly said, anatomically, if they get to know that you do a lot of this surgery, they all track you down.
Yeah.
But I think it's quite a predominant problem in the Asian subcontinent, isn't it?
Yes, very much. That is why actually we had a theme in Epsicon saying conquering the lost bastions. Sandeep will remember that.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, thank you. It's a really nice one.
And any of the specimens for biopsy also, madam?
All the specimens are sent for biopsy, actually. Because accidentally, if we miss malignancy. Yeah. Although I don't do any FNEC beforehand.
When you do breast reduction, when you have an axillary tail also,
yes.
What will be your...
same approach actually.
No, I have shown one case where there is a huge ventrous breast along with axillary tail.
Someone is talking. Yeah. I can't hear you.
Yeah. She is concerned only about... Hello?
Yes. Yes.
She is concerned only about the axillary tail only.
Yes.
But
yes.
In case if you want to address the breast hypertrophy also, what will be your kind of incision? Would you like to go through a separate incision?
Yes, yes. I go through the separate incision because even in breast reduction, we never reach that area from which we can pull down the axillary tail and, address that. So, we need to take separate incision in the axilla, and I have done it on few occasions.
Dr. Bhave, just a question. Do you use drains in this area when you remove
it? No, sir. I don't use any. In fact, I don't use drains in abdominoplasty also.
Very good.
So that was the first paper from India on drainless abdominoplasty.
Yeah.
And I was lucky to demonstrate at JIPMER and Assam Medical College my technique.
Sure. Even sometime, even following a sentinel node biopsy for breast cancer in the axilla, people end up with seroma. But you are taking a fair amount of tissue from the axilla.
Yes.
It's good to have no seroma. Any particular tips that you do?
As I said, I don't rely on pressure garment because if you look at the shape of axilla, the pressure garment can never give adequate pressure there to immobilize that flap. As I showed you, it is a stretchable dressing cut in specific way and it goes around the arm as well as on the chest wall.
Sure.
So that I can give a good pressure and immobilize. I keep it for 4 days, remove it, inspect the wound and then give it again for four more days. And that is enough.
Good. Good tip.
Yeah.
But in the beginning of their practice, they would say...
We can't hear you, Dr. Radhakrishnan. You are muted.
Again, everybody will, in the beginning of the practice, they would think that they can get away with the liposuction. But that is not so, usually. Unless you address the axillary tail completely, and sometimes you may have to go up to the foramen of Langer to close it also. Normally, we close it. We close it. So that, especially when you do other procedures, when you do only the axillary tail hypertrophy and leaving the breast, huge breast, just leave it. There is every chance of fat getting accumulated. Again, the patient can present with the same thing.
Yes.
Madam, there is one more question in the chat box. Do the neurovascular structures go through the mass or through the base of the swelling?
Intercostobrachial nerve almost invariably goes and you have to preserve it, as I said. And only the twigs that go through the mass and reach the skin that is to be removed can be sacrificed. Every other nerve has to be preserved because otherwise there will be a smarting pain along the supply area of that.
Yeah. Any tips in identifying the intercostal brachial nerve?
No, you just see it. See, what I do is I put adequate infiltration. So that there is hydrodissection and slowly as you are teasing out the breast by cutting only the fibrous septa, most of the times it is visible in the field. It is fairly big nerve for a plastic surgeon to spot it. Other surgeons may not spot it, but All qualified plastic surgeons would spot it.
Do you attempt to identify the nerve right in the mass or at the medial border where it is actually
right in the mass?
Well, right in the mass.
Okay. Because if you dissect the nerves there too much, they somehow they have a propensity to develop neuralgic pain. So I don't even try to, you know, skeletonize those nerves. This is not a malignancy surgery. So we don't need to do that.
The axillary fire, breast is too large, it will be tenting up the nerve.
Yes. So